Blackstone Audiobooks presents Magic Time, Ghostlands by Marc Scott Zicree and Robert Charles Wilson. The following dedication appears in the book. To Stuart Gordon Zicree and Christina Ann Zicree, beloved father and sister, for all the inspiration, and to the memory of Sue Ann Big Crow, who made magic in the real world. If anything is taught here, it is simply the charting of the life of someone who started out to somewhere and went. Ray Bradbury. We make our own ghosts, and then give them permission to haunt us. Magic Time, Angel Fire. Prologue, Grand Park, Chicago. Life is loss, Cal Griffin thought, standing in the chill wind off Lake Michigan, the dawn light like a held breath. Magic hour. Magritte's flames were dying to embers now, the ashes whipping in the breeze to dust their hair and shoulders and eyelashes. Another friend gone. Magritte, the flare, who had found sanctuary of a sort with Enid Blindman, then a true home in Goldie. Magritte had known much of the streets and of loneliness, and little of trust. She had trusted Cal. Cal and Doc and Colleen had set the wood and primed it, and Goldie himself had laid the empty husk of the girl sprite, still nearly weightless, onto the pyre. A new use for Grant Park, Cal reflected, as so many places and things had found new use. No more antiseptic forest lawn, where they carted the bodies off and sanitized them and put them on pristine display. No, death is its true self here, and no one keeps clean hands. The somber sweet a cappella of Enid's funeral song trailed away. His face turned to heaven, shining like cherry wood in the rose light. He moved off with Venus, who gulped back her tears, and Howard Russo, who bunched his shoulders and squinted his big grunter eyes against the pallid glare, despite his sunglasses. A last stop for them as autumn waned before they returned to the preserve, to Mary McRae and Kevin Elksings and the other strays and changelings. All the new combinations, the surrogate families, the desperate, brave attempts to find security and belonging in a world that had shattered to fragments. Cal glanced at Doc and Colleen, grouped together in the unspoken way that declared a country with borders all its own. Cal felt a pang of loss, and yet was not surprised. They were right together. She, so hard on the outside and sensitive within, he with his air of gentility and subtle inner strength. They would need that in the days ahead. They would need each other. As for Cal, whatever longings he felt or imagined futures he might have once entertained, he knew he needed to relinquish. He could little afford encumbrances now, attachments to slow him or bring hesitation or doubt. He had an appointment in the West. In the early days of last summer, a world away and a lifetime ago, a shockwave had spread out of the unknown heart of the country, a tremor that had stilled all machines permanently, had leached away their energies to power other dread forces, and left its mark on every man, woman, and child. Most had stayed human, pitifully, inadequately human. A few discovered they had strange new powers to move objects at a distance, or cast fear, or otherwise alarm the populace. And a minority, the outcasts, Cal recognized, the most fragile or emotionally distanced, found themselves changed physically in ways that reflected their inner natures. Some, like his own lost sister Tina, metamorphosed into ethereal, radiant creatures that came to be known in some parts as flares or angel fire. Still others were compacted into grunters, loathsome, powerful homunculi that ran in packs and kept to the dark places of the earth. But even here there were eccentric loners like Howard Russo, who eschewed the more repugnant pursuits of their fellows, and who could be trusted, who could be friends. Then there were dragons. Eli Stern, lawyer supreme and Cal's former boss, had transformed into one of those appalling rarities back in Manhattan, where Cal's long pilgrimage had begun. A brilliant man, Stern, and a monster, really, even before the change laid its weighty hand on him. Stern's extreme makeover had unshackled him, freed him at last to do things he had previously only dreamt of. So he had tried to kill Cal on several occasions, perhaps out of some sick need for payback, some attempt to quash traits he sensed in Cal that he himself could never have. Or it might not have been that at all. Cal realized he had never truly understood Stern, that the man, the dragon, had in the end been a total enigma to him. At any rate, Stern had been the first to abduct Tina, when she was racked by fever in the midst of her transformation, mistakenly believing that only the two of them were changing, that somehow she was fated to share his road. Stern had spirited her away to an area atop the dead office building where he and Cal once worked, had oddly been something of a midwife.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.